The emperor did not increase its sale prices for the saw blades to reflect the new increase on anti-dumping duty. So they said, listen, if you have a higher anti-dumping duty rate deposit margin, the goal of which to reflect the dumping rate, it increases the cost of doing business, which must have some kind of effect on the prices. But there was no effect on the prices, at least for the company which was alleged to engage in the evasion. And they did it by weight of the importer shipments did not change, even though the product description changed, which is probative that they didn't shift to the different product, but rather they shifted the product description of the same product. So they engaged an expert and they further said the marketing channels also did not change, right? So the marketing channels remain the same, further probative that further probative that there was evasion taking place. On top of that, you have a legal entity change, right? So you have one company taking business of another company, but this legal entity status did not affect the real estate, right? It was the same physical address. Imports of merchandise were same. So in other words, you take one legal entity head, you put it on a place, you put it on another legal entity head, you, instead of a Mickey Mouse, you start to call yourself a Minnie Mouse, but that does not change the fact, if you were in fact a Mickey Mouse, that you do not become automatically a Minnie. So that's the argument they're trying to put forward. On top of that, so customs did say this type of allegation fits the reasonable suspicion prong, so customs gave that a go. So do you see the difference between the one that it's no go, where you just take the data and say, okay, they imported, and based on the importation, we see that there should have been X amount of duties, anti-dumping duties paid, but there was less than X amount of duties paid. Therefore, it's a cause of reasonable suspicion. That's a no go. But you have factors such as marketing channels, you have public data, you have legal entity change, you have the fact of product description change while the volumes didn't change. You have, in other words, you create a totality of circumstances, not like one factor is dispositive, but a bunch of factors are dispositive to create the appearance of impropriety, and that appearance of impropriety led customs to believe, under reasonable suspicion standard, that there is something going on to initiate the investigation. All right, last but not least, notice of final determination. So customs went through the trouble and decided to say, yes, there is likelihood of evasion taking place. In this case, concerns the, what is called, the hangers, right? You have steel wire garment hangers, right? The steel wire hangers, kind of like when you go to one of those laundry places to dry clean your suit or your dress, and you get it back on a nice steel wire hanger. That's the type of stuff we're talking about. So the allegation concerned the possibility of transshipment. There is an anti-dumping duty imposed for wire hangers that come from People's Republic of China. But if they come from country of Thailand, then and they're actually made in Thailand, then there is no anti-dumping applicable. But you have to meet that transformation. You have to meet that origin requirement in order to not pay anti-dumping duty, which also goes in to the very important point that origin criteria Department of Commerce even though it defers to customs for origin criteria, which is making a new article of commerce, it still has it can still apply its own origin criteria within the anti-circumvention orders, where it says, okay, those operations are designed to circumvent the anti-dumping duty, so we're going to extend the application of anti-dumping duty or to those operations, even though they may confer the qualifying operations under the customs law. One of the examples that comes to my head is the candles. So if you bring in the candle with a wick, right? It's classified as a candle, right? But if you bring a candle without a wick, it is classified as a paraffin wax. And I believe that's what was happening. So the industry decided, okay, we'll bring the wickless candles, classify them as wax, therefore avoid the anti-dumping duty, and put the wick inside the candle in the United States. So that's less expensive than to pay the anti-dumping duty. Department of Commerce, I think they did the review and they said, hey, listen, that's circumventing the order. So they extended the applicability of order even to those type of operations. So now going back to the hangers. So what took place and how, and this is interesting from the perspective of how customs as an organization, how do they verify, how do they investigate the criteria? Because remember the criteria here now that you have now that the investigation is underway, it's not a reasonable suspicion, it's substantial evidence. So you have a different standard applicable here as a substantial evidence. So what customs has done is they went to the exporter or the alloy manufacturer and they said, okay, so you produce X number of hangers, prove us that that you do that. There is a standard way to show to customs that you are actually producing something in the quantities that are producing. Because to make an output for X amount of units, there is information such as electricity usage, such as employment records, such as facility records, such as inputs records, supplies, ordering of supplies, purchase orders, all the stuff which leave traces of production, which customs looks at to conclude, did the production actually take place? So where did the raw material come from? If you make a million hangers, but your raw materials, you can produce the evidence that for raw materials that only have a capacity to make 500,000 hangers, right? Then there is a big question mark, right? So corporate structure affiliations, right? Do you order it at the arm's length, right? Is there you go with the related parties? So there is a likelihood for you to provide the records which are not as sincere as they would have appeared otherwise. Source of finished hangers, supporting sales documentation, contracts, etc. So this is the stuff that they looked at. And what do you have? You have lack of response or very little response, no additional factual information. You have, so customs visited the factory in Thailand and they said, okay, this factory cannot produce the amounts that were imported and that import documentation showed that that factory was the source of production for those hangers. And then the accountant said, but they provided inconsistent sales, so they could not corroborate production annual production estimates of steel wire hangers. And then the so-called accountant said that she was only a translator. So, so there is a lot of question marks being raised over here, right? Significant discrepancies between information that the exporting place, exporting entity provided in its response, right? Or importing entity, I'm sorry. So hours of operation, fraction of machinery that was operational, right? No staff to operate the machinery. Then whatever stuff you had that you make wire from, they were rusty, and they were insufficient to keep the production running beyond few days. So so that's evidence of credibility based on Thailand production. But customs went beyond that, and they tried to trace stuff to the Chinese sources. And they say that CBP was able to link over 80% of imports through transshipments from China into Thailand. So stuff comes from China to Thailand and then gets boxed up and then goes into the United States market. That's called transshipment. Country of origin doesn't change. Therefore, ADD, anti-dumping duty, should be applicable. But documents say country of origin Thailand. So obviously people who decided to make the declaration, they, for once, they did not take this customs broker class, because they wouldn't know, they otherwise they would know that you have to have substantial transformation taking place, or they were driven by other motives than the compliance. They were driven by other motives, such as profiteering motive, right? All right. So insufficient production capability supports the conclusion that the true country of origin was China, not Thailand. So then again, they say the transshipment. And because of the transshipment, they concluded they determined that based on substantial evidence, so you have factory visits, you have conflicting information, you have lack of the documentation, lack of resources on site, and on top of that, you have evidence that there is stuff that are coming from China and they're being transshipped, that would make the substantial evidence. So the importer said, hey, wait, I'm an innocent victim. I had no clue that this is taking place. I'm not an evil evader. It's those guys overseas, they misled me into thinking that this is Thailand. It's all their fault. Why should I take the beating? And to which customs says, hey, listen, you're taking victim because not because you're an innocent victim. Innocence, your innocence has nothing to do with the statute under Enforcement Protect Act, because the statute's definition of evasion focuses on whether insufficient cash deposit bonds were made, not whether you're culpable evader. So level of knowledge of the evasion scheme is not determinative as to whether it evaded the applicable order upon the importation of covered merchandise for this investigation. So the party would have to pay the anti-dumping rate for transshipment, transship hangers of 187.25%. So nothing personal, just business. Your culpability is irrelevant. It's, we're looking at the objective criteria. So that would be the That would be an example of notice of final determination. So we went through the notice of non-initiation, initiation, and the final determination. We went through enforce and protect outline, standard of review, reasonable suspicion, and substantial evidence standards. We looked at the timeline, and we looked at the concept of interested party and the criteria for interested party to be submit to get through the investigation. Those are the major highlights of the Enforce and Protect Act under Part 165. So as more customs exams come underway, I'm very certain that more questions will arise. At this point, I think we have covered a good portion of the material to feel comfortable, at least to have a reference point to successfully answer future questions that are related to Enforce and Protect Act.